Well, let's take some time to pray. Father, I want to just thank you for the time we have in your word. And as we study the book of Isaiah tonight and finish up this overview, Lord, such a rich section of truth, Lord. And even though we're not dissecting it further and going line upon line and precept upon precept, Lord, we are still getting enough of this that it's a meal to our hearts. And so, Lord, we pray that you would prepare that. We'd be amiss, Lord, if all we were looking for is just mere information. What we desire every day is to fall more in love with you, and you give us so many reasons to do that. Matter of fact, there's never not a reason to fall more in love with you, because every day we get to discover a bit more how much you love us. And Lord, we pray that with that understanding of your great love for us, Lord, that you would cause us to examine our hearts to see if there's anything in our life, anything that would hinder us from benefiting and experiencing your love for us. And that requires us to be open to the work of the Holy Spirit through the Word of God and bringing conviction upon us in the areas that we can bring before your throne of grace, boldly approaching you, and to honestly admit what you already know to be true, the things that are hindering us from going deeper with you. And we thank you in advance for that work. We look forward to it by way of the Spirit of God. And may you increase, Lord, and us decrease. In Jesus' name, amen. Isaiah chapter 40, if you want to turn there. And this, of course, just will take a few minutes just to go back over the study a little bit, just to call into remembrance some of the aspects about that. The fact that the prophets are promises of God to the nation of Israel, and by way of them, some of them to us that relate directly. The review of this section of the prophets are 16 books, the final section of the First Testament. Some of those promises of God that we look at, like anything else we like, some of them, we realize that if we do not obey him and submit to him, we don't much care for those promises. It's like anything else in life. 13 of those 16 prophetical books happened before the Babylonian captivity, and the last three happened after it. So that's how you can divide it out. The last three of the books of the prophets are written after that. Regarding all 16 books, we realize that God has kept every promise down through history, and because of this, we can bank on the fact that he is always going to be faithful. Even if we don't like the reality of things in our life, so much years ago, there was a popular men's group. If you were around at that time and a believer, you probably remember the name of it. It's called Promise Keepers. And the emphasis there, and though accountability-wise was probably a good thing, it was emphasizing the fact that we, as in this case, men of God, should be those who are seeking to obey and submit our lives to the Lord. But over time, the movement, it was started by the head coach of the Colorado Buffaloes, the college football team. And over time, though, it began to emphasize the man's faithfulness above God's. And I remember going to a rally in Oakland, and they had people that were pastors. They wanted pastors to go on stage. I don't know how many thousands were there. The auditorium was packed, outdoor auditorium, and so that the people could call us promise keepers. Emphasis was on the fact that the servants of God were promise keepers. I refused to go. I didn't feel like I fit a promise keeper. I looked in the mirror and I feel like I'm a promise breaker. I thought the emphasis should have been much more on the faithfulness of God as being the promise keeper. He is the one that we should be adoring in stadiums, not the church, not men of God. I found the whole thing a bit, I don't know, weird. Now, maybe it started out well. I don't know. I just know the one I went to was like a pep rally for men to pat them on the back, and I thought it was a bit weird. But the thing we learned about looking at the prophetic word is that we have a faithful God that should be at all times the object of our praise and adoration. He alone is worthy. He alone is worthy, not any of his servants. And any servant of God, I was studying this week for 1 Peter and thinking about one of the things about the church. Any time where the church begins to emphasize the servants of the church, the denomination of the church, or anything about that, instead of him, it has already moved. It is in the wrong place. The emphasis should never be on the church. It should always be on him. And that's how we know we're in the right place. We know we're in the right place in our heart if the emphasis of the fellowship we go to or our own hearts is this, what we adore is him, not us. Then you know that that's a good place. It may not be the largest church on the block. It may not have the biggest building or the hottest worship team or pastor hasn't written a bunch of books or whatever else. But you know the heart is in the right place where he is getting the worship. Isaiah, we know this about him. He was married, had two sons according to the 8th chapter and the 7th chapter. He served as a prophet to Judah for 40 years, 740 years before Jesus. He spoke at a time when the 10 northern tribes were taken captive by the Assyrians and prophesied of Judah's future captivity to Babylon even before it was a world power, about 100 years prior. He's not the lone voice of this time frame. There were other prophets. Amos, Hosea, Micah all prophesied during the same time frame. Overview so far of Isaiah as a document or as literature. First half, 39 chapters, mirrors much of the First Testament. 39 chapters, filled with judgment, aimed at immoral and idolatrous men. 35 chapters of those 39 are centered upon the throne of God and his holiness. For instance, the 6th chapter where Isaiah writes of a vision of the throne of God during a time when Uzziah the king had died and Judah's earthly throne was vacant for a time. And I said last week, that's a very interesting reality just as far as an application point, because there will be times in our lives where it feels as if God is absent. You'll feel a time in your life where there appears to be nothing on the throne of your own heart. And it's an interesting perspective that Isaiah gives you, is that time when the nation would think it needed somebody in leadership the most. And it depends upon how you feel about our country now, but it feels to me as if it's leadershipless. And I know that you can lean right or lean left. Political campaigns are coming, and people may feel like we have a great leader or don't like the leader. But certainly just by the indication of where our nation is and its upheaval, and its turmoil and the things going on, it certainly would appear to be leaderless at this time as far as a bonding agent of a nation. Isn't it great to know that Christ is more real on the throne now? It should be causing the church at more than any other time in my Christian time to be rejoicing, because nothing that's going on right now has removed him from the throne. We can take great comfort in the fact that Isaiah said that he is high and lifted up and the train of his robe fills the temple. Right now, the Lord is on the throne. Irrespective of the turmoil in major cities and COVID-19 and I don't know whatever else is going on. I stopped watching the news 6 months ago. But whatever's going on, it's nice to know that the Lord is in control. And during seasons, and this is just an observation for your own heart to examine, during seasons like this, when a nation is in turmoil, wherever you live, wherever you're at, like the time of Judah when Uzziah was not on the throne and he had died, and this is a time where you can find out what you're trusting in. This, more than any other time, I think, is an indication. It's kind of, if you will, it's a test. It's a self-test. Test of the church, if you will. Test of the nation. Here's a man, a prophet of God named Isaiah, who has a vision and realizes that no matter what was going on in the nation, the 10 northern tribes taken captivity by the Assyrians, he's knocking on the door. Things are out in uproar. Things are a mess. Like no other time, this is a test to determine who you think is reigning. And if you're in uproar and there's no peace, and I know people that are freaking out of everything, you can ask yourself who's in control. And then what you gain out of that is not to judge someone else. You gained the ability to judge your own heart. And if you find that you are wigged out over what's going on in the world, you have an opportunity to make sure that you see the same vision. He's high and lifted up. His train fills the temple. Nothing to worry about. He's not, this is not passed over him. And I say that with some confidence, having lived the last 2 years of my life in turmoil. He was never not on the throne during those 2 years. Hospital visitations, 11 months away from the body of Christ, isolated, and the eventual homecoming of my wife, he was still on the throne. It didn't move me. It didn't change the reality. Matter of fact, if anything, it drew me closer. I realized that nothing in my life is as secure as my relationship with him. Worship him. So the next four chapters that Isaiah, after that, after six, God makes us aware of our shortcomings and our failure and our choices, and makes us realize that we want a Savior. Few of us may want a Lord, but who is upon the throne, because we don't like a Lord, because he'll judge us in our foolish attempts to rule our own lives. And then the final 27 chapters that we'll look at tonight, 40 through 66, resembles the New Testament, declare hope and grace. This is the division of our Bibles. People seem to lean heavier towards the New Testament, stay away from the First Testament. There are even Calvary chapels now that are advocating not reading the First Testament. I disagree. I think you get a great perspective, but what you have in the final 27 chapters of Isaiah indicate to us and introduces us to the clearest way. We need the first 39 chapters to show us our need. There's a reality about humanity, and that is that we don't, nobody puts on seat belts in an airplane because they like how well they feel. You're already in cramped seats and having to do microsurgery if you have to eat. It's already a mess. But if you find out that they're going to hit air pocket and go down 120 feet up and down because of air pockets, believe me, you're glad you have a seatbelt on. And what the 39 chapters of the first 39 chapters of the First Testament tell us is that we've got a problem here. We're in rough season life. We make failures. And those things cause us. By the way, you ever realize that most people do not turn to the living God apart from being a mess? We don't choose it because it's comfortable. Yes, I know Romans, the goodness of God enables us to say no to ungodliness. But it's his goodness in spite of our failure that does that. It's when we're desperate we turn to him. So we need the 39 chapters to these things are written for our admonition, to cause us to show us the need, not just for salvation, but to have somebody control our lives, be Lord of our lives, to take control of it. I do not like the phraseology says God is my co-pilot. I don't want God to be in the seat next to me as I crash the plane. Matter of fact, I don't even want to be in the seat next to him. I'll just take a back seat somewhere where I can just rest. I want him to pilot my life. And for people who want to know what their five-year plan is and want to know what the next few years hold for you, do you really want to know that? I don't. I want to live for just now, as if this is my last day, and make the most of everyone I can. We have the 27 chapters that show us that God's provision for man's need in the Messiah. They make the completion of the 66 books and the 66 chapters of Isaiah show us those two aspects are needed. We need to know, one, that we're hopelessly and helplessly lost, and two, that we have in Christ and in the Messiah the answer of what we need. Nobody goes in and decides they're going to take some horrible medicine until they know they're sick. And so we have to have 39 chapters to tell us that we're sick. You notice there's more to tell us that we're sick than we need someone else. And so there's probably a reason for that. The last section God offers through Isaiah are promises of hope, comfort, and restoration. And in chapter 40 through 48, the basis of the promises, and listen carefully. So in chapter 40 through 48, the basis of those promises is not man's compliance. Underline it. Highlight it. It's not the basis. The promises are not based on our compliance. They're centered upon God's sovereignty and majesty. There are 216 verses of those nine chapters. 115 of those speak specifically of God's greatness and power. And what we deduce by that truth is that God's promises are only appropriated by recognizing his nature and not by exalting ours. We are not to boast of what we're doing for God. Far too much of that on evangelical Christianity. I'm just going to pick on what we are. We're an evangelical church. But let us not talk about appropriating what we've done for God, that God loves us because, I mean, look at us. Who wouldn't love us, right? I mean, instead of doing that, his promises, and here's the great part of this. His promises are only appropriated by recognizing his nature. That means that we don't have to worry about losing them because they're based upon him and not us, and he's always faithful. We're not. It's amazing how people want to elevate their works above his work. If you have elevate your work, you have to take the other side of it. Of course, nobody ever does. God's nature is laid next to the idols of Israel. It was prone to elevate the deity of those. And over again, Isaiah speaks of Judah and their future restoration lies in the hands of a loving father, even though the children had chosen to reject his love and follow after worthless and idols and things that they themselves had created. Over 100 years before the events of Isaiah prophesied that Judah, though escaped the Assyrian captivity, would be taken captive rather by Babylon. Even though they did so, they didn't recognize it. And Judah would be judged just as Israel was in captivity. The next nine chapters, 49 to 57, concentrate on the coming of the Messiah, who will be their Savior and suffering servant. Now think about this. We know this from the New Testament. Here it's prophesied 740 years before the coming of the Messiah, those chapters, 49 to 57, nine chapters, deal with the Savior as a suffering servant. He'll be rejected by the very ones that have come. He's come to save. His purpose is to save them from the greatest adversary and tyrant, the one person that oppresses them more than any other, themselves. He will do this by placing their iniquities upon himself and paying for their sins. By his stripes they will be healed. But more than this, his coming will usher in a new kingdom of righteousness and peace And all those who place their trust in him will be delivered. And of course, he's dealing with the millennial reign of Christ for 1,000 years. That's all in those 9 chapters, 49 through 57. In the final 8 chapters, 58 through 66, Isaiah sees Jerusalem being rebuilt, again, the millennial reign, and Israel's borders being enlarged as the Messiah will reign out of Jerusalem. God's people will confess their sins, and those opposed his righteous rule will be judged. His kingdom and reign will be without end and characterized of peace, prosperity, justice, and you make all things new. So for the prosperity movement, people, you got to wait till the millennial reign. Other than that, you ain't going to get it. I don't care how much you confess it and send in seeds of faith. It will not make any difference. You will get your prosperity and peace at the righteous reign of the Messiah during the millennial reign. Now, for those of you who think you're in the millennial reign right now, hyper-Calvinists, please somebody tell Satan, because apparently he did not get the memo. We're coming to a time, whether we are raptured or die, and then we'll be in the millennial reign of Christ in glorified bodies. And for 1,000 years, Christ will reign here on earth, before the new heavens and the new earth. And Isaiah sees the millennial reign. 740 years before the coming of the Messiah, he sees it. So let's kind of take a look at this now in a more specific nature. Isaiah 40 verse 11, Isaiah speaks of the promise that he will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young. After stating God's willingness to lead them, Isaiah reveals God's ability to do so in chapter 40, verses 12 through 13. He asks, by asking, "Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and measured the heaven with a span and calculated the dust of the earth in a measure, weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who has directed the Spirit of the Lord, or as his counselor has taught him?" Isaiah states his conclusion in chapter 40, verse 28, saying, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator to the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary. His understanding is unsearchable. The assurance of the promises lies with the promiser and not with the recipients of the promises." What a great statement. The assurance of the promises lies with the promiser, God, the living God, and not with the recipients of the promises. Our assurance isn't based on us. It's New Covenant Theology 101. Because of that, we can have great comfort and peace. He knows our frame. He remembers us. He knows everything about us, and he still chooses to love us. And furthermore, he knew it before he formed you. Redemption isn't based upon our goodness. It's based on his. In Isaiah 41, 7 through 18, we read yet another promise. As we're told, "The poor and needy seek water, but there is none. Their tongues fail for thirst." And listen to the promise. "I, the Lord, will hear them. I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will open rivers in desolate heights and fountains in the midst of the valleys. I will make the wilderness a pool of water and dry land springs of water." And who's the one that does that? The ones that hears them? What's he like? Well, Isaiah chapter 42, 2 through 4 tells us, "He will not cry out, nor raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break." You might remember that verse. "A smoking flax he will not quench. He will bring forth justice for truth. He will not fail nor be discouraged till he has established justice on the earth. And the coastlands shall wait for his law." Among other things, we are told in chapter 42, verse 7, that he will open blind eyes, bring out prisoners from the prison, those who sit in darkness from the prison houses. And in chapter 43, 1 through 2, he promises, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you out by your name. You are mine." Wow. There's a promise you can have. You are mine. He didn't say only the good ones, only the on fire Christians, which I always wonder what that was. He says, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. And when you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. You ought to have that one marked in your Bible. Isaiah 43:1-2. But listen carefully to hear that promise. He did not say you wouldn't pass through the waters. No, he promised that he would be with you and that they wouldn't overflow you. He did not promise that you wouldn't walk through fire. No, he promised that you would not get burned and the flames would not scorch you. In other words, he didn't make this a bed of roses. He will never leave you or forsake you is what he's promising. We can receive that promise because he says in chapter 43:4 and verse 13 that you were precious in my sight. You've been honored and I have loved you. Indeed, before the day was, I am, and there is no one who can deliver you out of my hand. I work, and who will reverse it? Now, for those who believe you can lose your salvation, you probably want to not underline that verse. If it's based upon you, I guess you could lose it. But read it again. Who can deliver you out of my hand? I work, who can reverse it? I'd say that if salvation was based upon me, I could lose it. If it's based on him, I cannot. Now, the question is whether you're truly saved. So, is there a possibility that somebody's claiming that promise that isn't saved? Yes. As much as you're truly saved, you're truly secure. And of course, I am the full judge of all of that. No, I'm not. I wouldn't know. But I believe I'm secure because I'm truly saved. I cannot deliver myself, and I have not delivered myself, and it's not based on my faithfulness. Matter of fact, there's times where I think I need to get saved every moment of the day, which is like today. But the security is based on that. How wonderful these promises are, but what if we mess it up? There's the question. What if I do something and walk away? Well, listen to what he says in Isaiah 43:25-26. I, even I, am who blots out your transgressions for my own sake. I will not remember your sins. Put me in remembrance. Let me contend together. State your cause that you may be acquitted. What? Confess it, man. He already knows it. And then Isaiah 46:9-10, God says, remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there's none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. And then in chapter 48:12, God says, listen to me. I am he, I am the first, and I am also the last. The next nine chapters, 49-57, focus on the Messiah's incarnation. And we're told in chapter 49:2 that he has made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand he has hidden me and made me a polished shaft. In his quiver he has hidden me. Chapter 49:6, the Messiah will be given as a light to the Gentiles that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. In 49:16, the Messiah declares, I have inscribed you in the palms of my hands. And then he asks in chapter 50:2, is my hand shortened at all that I cannot redeem? Or have I no power to deliver? Indeed, with my rebuke, I dry up the sea and make the rivers a wilderness. Gee, I think he did that. Chapter 50:6, he declares that he gave my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who plucked out my beard. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. And it said in chapter 52:7, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who proclaims peace, who brings glad tidings of good things, who brings salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Of him who proclaims peace, we're told in chapter 52:14-15, that his visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations. And we have the amazing description of his suffering in Isaiah 53. should be one that we all have underlined. And we read in chapter 54, verse 5, that our Maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the whole earth. And with this revelation comes an invitation to chapter 55, verse 1. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy, and eat. Yes, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. If you're a good Christian. No, not there. How is it possible to be satisfied without a cost? Well, it's because we read in chapter 53 that he's already paid the cost for us. The majesty of this is beyond our understanding. And thus his words to us in chapter 55, verses 8 through 9, where he says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." With such truth, we're told the promise that according to chapter 55, verse 11, "My word be that goes forth from my mouth, it shall not return to me void, but it will accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the things for which I sent it." Wow. His promise is towards those, according to 57:15, to dwell in the high and holy place, with him who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. Now, if you want to know your work, if you want to know what it is called, David said it, "A broken and contrite heart, these, O Lord, you will not despise." If you want to grow close to the Lord, brokenness is where it's at. Don't try to get fixed. Remain broken. The final eight chapters, 58 through 66, we see the final benefits of living under the Messiah's reign. Is it any wonder in chapter 58, verse 12, he will be known as the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets to dwell in. In chapter 59, verse 17, we're told that he put on righteousness as a breastplate and the helmet of salvation on his head. He put on the garments of vengeance for clothing, and he was clad in zeal as a cloak. And it is because of this that we're told in chapter 60, verses 1 through 3, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and the deep darkness of the people, but the Lord will rise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And the Gentiles shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising." And in chapter 60, verse 19, we're told that the sun shall no longer be your light by day, and your brightness shall the moon give you light, but the Lord will be to you an everlasting light, and your glory, and your God your glory. Chapter 61, verses 1 through 3. By the way, in chapter 60, verse 19, it is an indication of what heaven's going to be like. There's no darkness. There's no shadow, according to 1 John. There's nothing with God. All brightness all the time. 61, verses 1 through 3, he declares, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to counsel those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the light, for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." Is it any wonder that Jesus spent so much time reading from the scroll of Isaiah? Remember when he was there in the gospel accounts and he rolled down the scroll and preached it? This whole section is about him. It's an amazing prophecy. In Isaiah 63:1, he says, "I who speak in righteousness, mighty to save." In chapter 64:4, he declares, "Since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you, who acts for the ones who wait for him." Man, what an invitation this is. If we will but wait for him, we shall see him act on our behalf. We have nothing to worry about. This just reading this tonight ought to give you complete peace and security. It ought to make you go, man, I can curl up no matter what's going on because he's in control. Chapter 64, verse 8 says, "But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are clay. You are our potter. And all we are is work, are the work of your hand." Such promises are not just for now, but as chapter 65, verses 17 through 19 promises, "Behold, I create a new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing, and her people as joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem, the joy of my people. And the voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her, nor the voice of crying." And finally, in chapter 66, 1 and 2, we read, "Thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you shall build me?" Church, you might want to read this one. "And where is the place of my rest? For all these things my hands has made, and all those things exist, says the Lord. But on this one I will look, on him who is poor and of contrite spirit, and who trembles at my word." And we'll leave Isaiah alone. But it's a phenomenal study. I encourage you to spend time reading it, enjoying it, devouring it. I think, just from what we have in the gospel, I think Isaiah was a favorite of our Lord's. He seems to have quoted it quite a bit. And a lot of things in Isaiah are quoted about him. So it's worthy of reading it. Next week we take up Jeremiah. Two-weeker. If you don't have it, there should be there. But a lot to digest in Isaiah. Father, we thank you for this time and the riches of your word. Just even reading some small scattering of your scriptures. What a reminder it is for us who are called by your name. Our privilege, Lord, is to look upon your majesty, your greatness, with such wonder that it causes us to be broken and contrite in spirit. To uphold how wonderful you always are. And because of that, Lord, to always recognize our great need for more of you and less of us. Lord, we pray that you would receive all the glory and praise, not just in our words and our worship, but in our lives. As we walk on the paths of the dusty world we live in, Lord, may we be instruments that you could place the light of your word in us that would magnify how great you are. For those that are lost in darkness would be drawn to your light. And Lord, I pray that you would enable each of us to be people like that, Lord. Thank you for shining your light upon our hearts tonight, Lord, for revealing to us the things that our hearts and lives need to yield to. And Lord, we pray that you would be magnified. We pray as your servant John prayed, "Lord, come quickly." We long for your justice and your righteousness to reign upon this earth, and for your reign to be for everlasting and everlasting. And we also know, Lord, that you are a merciful God, and there are yet people who have not yet experienced your goodness. It is their own failure and stubbornness that brought them there, just as it was ours. So, Lord, in your mercy, as your time is always perfect, use us to draw people to you for your glory. Breathe upon your church renewal and revival that we might be effective instruments in your hands, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. A lot to chew on. If you haven't got Jeremiah yet, I think it's in the back.